Don't you forget you're special.
We were all born different, even those that look alike. Even twins of differences ain't can be.
Gotcha.
I'm not wearing my clothes backwards. Oh, hey, how y'all doing? Anyway, sorry, we got caught up. Welcome to the Able Show. I am your host, Olden Polonies, and as you can see, joined by my amazing co-host. What up, Scott?
Hey, how's it going?
Rebecca, Kendra. Look at y'all. Wow. I like.
Thank you.
Okay. I like.
Yeah, recording. He's just here, you know.
Best one here.
Okay, if you say so, Scott. Hey, that's the first step, believing it.
Right.
Anyway, as you know, on the Able Show, we bring you amazing guests. You know, when we do our show, we talk about all sorts of topics. And today is no different. We have a gentleman that is synonymous with, I mean, just hard work. When we come back from break, we are going to be joined by Mr. Clyde Jones. And trust me, you know Clyde.
Don't you forget you're special.
Hey, you are special, and don't forget it. Even when everyone neglects to mention how you did for them when they didn't. I know life ain't always fair, but keep living. Cause after you lose it, that's when you miss it. And when you need them, that's when.
Bravo 36, this is Bravo 6. Request situation in your AO. Over.
We here, huh?
Ho. You got a warrant?
You got a license to sell young girls?
All right.
Glad to have you here.
Thank you, DJ X-Ray.
Yeah.
So, as you can see, we are joined by the legend, Mr. Clyde Jones. Mm-hmm. So, let's get to it, man.
Yes, sir.
Since you brought it up. So, let your soul glow.
You know, but as you can see, the juice is gone.
Oh, man, that Jerry Carr ate it up, huh?
You should see the ball spot in my hair. Thank you, hairdresser. Yeah, buddy.
So, I know people know you from there. I mean, but you've done a million freaking projects. But talk about coming to America and the whole soul.
You know what? I tell you, when I was in college, I went to USC. I was one of the men of USC pinup guys. You know, they had one of them number one calendars. Whatever.
Yeah, you were like the guy.
So, I had auditioned for this thing. My agent, I was with Cunningham at the time, so I was working all the time, a little active. So, they auditioned me and told me to come to Paramount. There's this role in this movie called Coming to America. And then they said, you know, it's a lot of Africans and stuff like this. So when my agent called me, I said, well, I'm not going to be wearing no diapers or nothing. Now, you're not asking me. Oh, little, this is my thing, because I've done some stuff where I had to put diapers on as a model and stuff. You know, like, oh, come on. I'm not putting no spear in my hand. I didn't know what it was about. So I go to Paramount Studio, and I meet this guy, Barry, one of the producer writers. And he said, well, I'll put this wig on. I say, pardon me? You put the wig on. I want to see how you look with this. I'm thinking, what is this movie about? I had no clue. So then he's like, shake your head. So I'm sitting there like, okay. Then he was talking to the other guy. Now I know this sounds crazy. He was talking to this one guy. And he says, well, you know, I think he's kind of dark. Do you think he might be a little too dark for this role? And I said, no. My skin got red in it. So I'm still trying to get the job too. But it was a print job too. So
I got Indian in it.
I still get Kamala, I'm Kamala. So look, I said, look, I got Indian in him. I told him, I said, I have red in my skin. So by the time I got to the parking lot, they said, you got it. I said, what did I get? I didn't have no clue what I got.
Wow.
You know, and I'm so glad that Eddie did not do that role. He did every role, but I guess he forgot about Soul Glow. So I'm so glad, Eddie, thank you for forgetting about Soul Glow. So
wow.
It's been iconic and it's been just a great thing. I got Soul Glow tennis shoes. You know, they're not.
Wait,
actually,
what?
That's Giannis. What's his name from the Milwaukee Bucks?
Giannis?
Yeah, he's got a tennis shoe called the Greek Freak Tennis Shoe, Soul Glow. So he liked my character so well, the young lady and I, he put me on
a
tennis shoe. So when they go into your archives, you'll see the little tennis shoe, the Soul Nike. So I have a deal with Nike and Paramount.
Wow, that's crazy.
That's cool.
Yeah, so I was so cool to get on the tennis shoe. I'm like, yeah.
With the wig on and everything.
That's been a blessing, though, literally.
Wow.
It's been a blessing doing that, doing the Soul Glow. They call me in sometimes for the Essence to do some stuff. So it's been iconic. So I can tell you, I had a great time with that character.
Awesome, awesome. When he directs, you know, of course, everybody, Clyde is also the director of The Able Show.
Yeah.
And, but he's a legend in the game.
We love you, Davina. You're just wonderful. She, you know, she talked to me about a vision one time. I'm like, Davina, that is the most incredible thing I've ever heard in my life. You know, and I was up, I was in.
What's
no, but I've worked with her a long time, and she told me about her vision. I was touched.
Yeah.
You know, then she showed me all the colors and stuff. Like, my
God. It all just
God.
Makes sense. It works.
You know, who could say no to this?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
So
it's the most incredible. I've done a lot of stuff, and I thank God for it, but out of the most rewarding stuff, you know, this is very rewarding to me, you know. I've worked with a lot of kids and, you know, teenage pregnancy, STDs, gang violence, and all this kind of stuff, you know, but this just really touched my heart. So she don't know that I'm happier to have it than, you know, that she knows. So I just thank
awesome.
Her. You
know? So I want to know, like, where did your origins start? Like, I know the Clyde that you are now. I want to know, how did you begin?
As far as me being an actor, you know, I left New Orleans and went to school in Oregon. I didn't really want to go because I didn't know there was black people there. You know, all people kept saying, Oregon.
Right.
My aunt said, why don't you come on down to Oregon, baby? I said, any black people in Oregon? So I get to Oregon, and that's where it all started, because I went to a school called Savannah in, I think it was in near Lake Oswego in okay. Oregon, Portland, you know where.
Portland.
Yeah. So I went there, and I was a dancer as well, and I played football. I wanted to go to USC to play football. That was my first thing. You know, I got a little in me, old. So, but ironically, I ended up taking acting classes. You know, like, I was really not a good student in high school. I was dyslexic. I'm literally, I was just not good at all. I was like, but I was a good student, so they wanted to pass me because he was a good kid. You know, military daddy, this good kid, and I was quiet, didn't say nothing to nobody. And but I wanted to play sports, and I took some classes, some ballet classes, because, you know, Lynn Swan, everybody took classes as wide receivers. So I took some classes, and then I got a semi-scholarship to USC, because I applied for it, and my girlfriend at the time applied for it. And a good friend of mine, this guy, Matt Latanzi, and he ended up marrying Olivia Newton-John. So when I was there, I said, man, I'm going to L.A., and I'm going to try to be an actor, maybe play some football. He said, I might go and marry Olivia Newton-John. Matt, please. So I'm at USC. I'm looking at the People's Magazine. I see him and Olivia Newton-John on the mag. I said, he met her in Xanadu.
Wow,
Xanadu.
He met her in Xanadu. That's what he meant. Real handsome guy, Italian guy, real cool man, fisherman. I mean, he's like, they're devils. You know, they go out in the water under the. That was too much. Come on, Clyde, go scuba diving. Are you crazy?
Hey, man, can I tell you something?
Yes, sir.
If you were directing right now, you'd be over there going, bam, you know, meaning I got to take a break.
Oh, okay,
you want to hold that thought for a minute?
Okay, can I say it?
Like, come back to a different...
Can I give it to you? Bam!
You got to take a quick break when we come back more with Clyde Risley Jones.
Oh.
I feel like a complete idiot.
Oh, do not be ridiculous.
You know, you can be all the things you've always wanted to be. Beautiful, sexy, easy as 1, 2, 3.
Just let your soul glow. Just let it shine through. Just let your soul.
Back there. DJ X-Ray.
X-Man.
That's some good music.
Well, X-Man show. Yeah, he plays good music. That's DJ X-Ray back there.
That's
doing his thing.
All
Right.
Anyway, we're back with Clyde Jones, the original Soul Glow man, the only Soul Glow man.
Mm-hmm. One.
But you've done so much other stuff. I mean, Tour of Duty, Woman Doubt, Loose. I mean, but
feels like, what's been your like favorite role?
Like that, Kendra. Cut me off. No,
I'm not a comedian.
We know.
But my favorite role is when you get paid.
Right.
Anytime you get a good lipstick. You know what? No, I'd be honest with you. I played a character called, it was Satan.
In this play,
Tell Hell I Ain't Coming. You know, and I was actually one of the directors and writers of it. But it was really a good play. It's about a pastor that dies and go to hell.
Wow.
But he's only dead for, he was in church in a sermon, and all of a sudden he dies. He's only dead for about 2 minutes, but he goes into hell and he sees his congregation. He doesn't know if he's going to make it in hell, you know, so he gets to the gate and he looks for his name, Bishop Allgood. And the guy, you know, he's at the gate saying, well, I see no good, almost good, couldn't have been good. You know, and he finds, he's like, oh, and he said, why is my name not in the book? He said, you must be in the other book. So he gets the other book and dust comes. He said, all right, there you are. He said, well, let me in. He said, well, you got to go to the other gate. He said, I thought there was only one way to heaven. He said, well, it is, but you're going to that gate. You know, so he meets me down there. Hey! All good. Hey! I even scared myself. I actually just have to pray before I did the role. We did. Went over in London. We did it all over. We did it for a long time.
Yeah.
Charles Penland was the director. Marcia Samuel was the writer. And we just traveled. But that was one of the good roles because being a Christian man, you know, Satan himself in this thing was actually telling the story. You know, he was actually telling Allgood, all your life you taught people not to follow me. Well, here you are, right where you are. I always want you to be. You're mine, and you'll never get out. You know, so he started speaking the Bible to him, you know, which was really deep. So it was one of them roles that I was able to really get into because I wanted this pastor to win to get back to earth, you know. So eventually he recites the Bible and he takes the Bible, he uses the Bible as his weapon, you know, and then he wakes up, you know, back in ceremony. I saw you, and you were there, like Dorothy. You were there and I saw you, you did this, you know. Wow. Tell hell I ain't coming, you know. So it was one of those, that's one of the favorite roles that I
did. Now you played a Haitian dude in Haitian Nights.
Haitian Nights.
Called Franz.
What
was that about?
You know what?
And you're doing the Haitian thing. Scratch your hand. That's money coming.
Listen,
hold on right quick. I have a friend that's a comedian, right? He goes, my mother, all Haitian women do this. Like, after about 10 years, she's like, you know, in Haiti, we call it l'argent.
Okay.
He's like, my mom used to always, l'argent. It's like, no, mom, doctor.
You know what? We shot it in Miami. I think Miguel was in there as well. We shot it in Miami.
Miguel Nunez.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Oh, see, I got a bone. See, you know what? I've been directing this show, you know, and my friends get on the show. They just put me in the hot seat.
Everyone lights you up. It's hilarious.
But I tell people the secret to that is I don't mind being the butt of the joke because then they put me on TV and they do all the kind of stuff. So they think they get me, but they get me paid. You know what I'm saying?
So,
but I have a good time with this. That's 40-something years of friendship, you know? So it's like we just
been knowing each other
and we just have a great time. I appreciated them being able to be on the show.
So that's how you got that role?
Well, no, actually, a friend of mine talked, I think Mark Casey was directing that. You know Mark Casey, director Mark Casey? Yeah, so he hired me and I went to Florida and I did the role and... It was a vacation. It was a lot of beautiful women.
You have an accent? Did you do a Haitian
accent? No, I did. I did a Haitian accent. I tried. I don't know it now, but I had to practice it.
Oh.
You
know,
I'm curious about your cowboy look, because like everyone like says like you're not really a cowboy, and that sometimes you pretend to be a cowboy.
I tell. Look, I am from Texas.
Cause you got some good boots.
I was born a cowboy.
Yeah.
I'm a Dallas Cowboys fan. You know what I'm saying? I like my
ladies
cowboy
hats. Ladies and gentlemen, this man is so full of crap.
Yes, I am.
But I've heard that you couldn't even ride a horse.
He came in here this morning looking like Woody from Toy Story.
Yeah, I took the little vest off.
Yeah, you had the little vest.
But Woody
on.
Had a cowboy hat on.
Yeah.
See, Woody,
actually, you're right. That is cowboy-ish.
Look, I was still Woody. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. How many pairs of cowboy boots do you have then?
Because I'm slew-footed, kind of like. All my boots is leaning to the side, so I have to change the heels, and I just change these heels.
Yeah, I can see, and there's like a little level.
I just change them, and I just.
That's not the question of the young lady. Yeah,
also
answer the question.
I have four
man.
Pair. My friend Reggie got 30 pair.
Yeah,
Reggie
but he's a real cowboy.
He got 30 pair of boots. Yeah. I was at his house, just 30 pair of boots.
Man, boots are expensive.
Yeah, yeah. Good boots. Yeah. Good
but he brag on not being expensive. He said, see these $60. This was, that's what he'll say, $60.
Where the hell did he get $60 cowboy boots?
Oh, you can find some. Matter of fact, my brother brought me back a hat from Biloxi the other day. Two Cowboys hat, there was $150 a piece. He got them for $10 a piece.
What? Where? Like,
in Biloxi, it was a sale. For two white cowboy hats.
Nice.
I got them here. I started to wear it today, you know, but I said, you know what? Just, I don't want to do that.
Then how many hats?
Yeah. Oh, please wear the white cowboy hat one day.
Yeah.
I wear it. I got two of them. So I wear.
Oh, my God. Please. Yeah. So I can laugh.
Yeah. But you was here with all my friends dogging me out. But I can't dog you out because I just love you so much. I need you.
I love you, too.
Who is Clyde after the shoots, after the cameras and rolling and everything?
Ooh, great.
I'm the same person. You know, my thing is this. And Davina, no, I'm me. You know, I'm gonna be Clyde. My friends come, I'm the same Clyde. You know, I love people. I love working with children and young adults and elders, you know, and I live vicariously through them. That's my fun in life. You know, I don't really like being on the camera no more. I've been getting anxiety and all kind of stuff. You get older and it's like panic attacks. Like, I don't wanna, you know, Miguel actually got me on that show, Family Business New Orleans. It's a new series. So Carl Weber and them, they say, well, we'll get him, you know. So I got on, I didn't audition. I boom, get on that Bernadette status call, and she said, we want Clyde, Stephen Williams.
Bernadette,
it's Clyde.
Who?
Bernadette. Stannis?
Thelma?
Yeah. Yeah, Thelma. As a matter of fact, we going to get on the show over here. I just.
I get Thelma on the show.
Look, I just left
her. I'll be no good.
No, I just left Thelma.
I'm letting y'all know right now.
No.
That is my crush of
I should call her right now.
You're calling right now.
I just left Thelma in Jackson, Mississippi.
Oh my
she was doing the thing
God.
On Good Time. So they had me speaking, and she and I are going to do a two-person show.
Wow.
It's a funny show. So we're working on it now. So we'll let you know.
Yeah, Thelma. Anyway, we're going to take a quick break, and when we get back, more with Mr. Clyde Jones.
Bam!
Bam!
Him. I gotta go fix my makeup.
Mr. Frank Schaefer.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Welcome to our family. I'm Vi, I raised Janice, and looking at you, I know I raised her right. Those are the other two sisters.
Yes. Cute, and cute. The dangerous combination.
Well, why don't you come in and make yourself comfortable?
Come on.
Your little woman will be down any minute.
Great.
Thanks a lot, buddy.
Thanks.
Baby.
Hey, my brother, you gonna let her tip him like that? Man, what does she do when y'all eat out?
Everybody, this is Frank. Frank, this is everybody. Come on, honey, I'll show you to your room.
Excuse me, but what happened to the little lady y'all promised me?
Here's $5. Go find your own.
Blondie's girl is fine and hip. And this S-Curl style says my hair is whipped. Wednesday's girl, I can persuade. With this look, I know my hair's laid. With S-Curl style, I'm good to go. And Friday's girl lets me know. Sunday's girl is the best. She makes
him forget all the rest.
For smooth styles, S-Curl's going on. For the man.
The
one and only.
Soul glow man, Clyde Jones. You guys will never live that one.
And you shouldn't. Yeah.
So I want to ask you, Emancipation. Can you speak a little bit about that?
You know, that's an interesting story. I worked with Will a long time ago in First Prince of Bel Air. Okay. You know, it was a scene called Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. They thought I was going to marry
you. With a cab driver.
Yeah, that was a cab driver.
Yeah, they thought you were the fiance.
At the end, I said, what happened to the girl you promised me? You know?
Yeah. So,
It was really good. I think Kim Harding had cast me in that. But to be able and I've talked to Will along the way because he plays a lot of basketball, him and Carlton, all of them. We have a good time. So I had an audition for Emancipation. And normally I'm the type of actor that goes in just dress the character. You know, a lot of the cast directors in New Orleans, they're like, no, they're dressing like that. You know, just come in. I'm like, nope, because I'm so used to it here. I'm not going to change what I do there. Yep. You know, and I like to get engulfed in the character. So a friend of mine, I went to her house and she taped me. And after the taping is over, she looked at me. She said, oh my God, this is your role. And I'm saying, girl, this. And I'm looking at everybody wanting this role. Like when I did James Brown, Get On Up, everybody wanted these type of iconic type of roles. So I end up getting the role. Two lines. 2 days. And I'm sitting there like, it was time to do the role. And fear started coming on me. I'm like, two lines, what's going on? I'm used to monologue. Nervous, didn't want to do it. I had to go around my house doing Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, literally, I'm like, what is going on? And because there was a blessing, I didn't know was coming, okay? Wow. See, because me and God, we'd be talking, you know, just do it, you know? And let me go back real quick so you guys would know something. When my mother was here, my dad was here, my grandmother was here, my aunt was here, everybody was here, now they're gone. You know what I'm saying? And I live to make them happy. You know what I'm saying? So when they left, you try to figure out another way to keep going.
With
you know,
them.
You know, my aunt taught me how to act when I was 5, you know, just having a good time. I wanted to just be like that. But anyway, to get back to the movie. So what happened was, I'm on my way to the set. Now mayhem is happening. Things falling off the cars in front of my car. Rain started coming. I mean, it was like, what is going on? Wow. I get there and I start sweating profusely. I'm like, oh my God, sweating. They thought I had a COVID. You know, I was like, and like they start giving me Gatorade. I'm like, what is this? What's happening? So anyway, I get on the set and I'm like in character. You know, I'll get you guys some pictures. I'm in character, and everybody's looking at me like, wow, he's
in it.
Who is this guy? You know, I played a preacher in it, but my face was like rugged and stuff like that. So Will is walking down, I see Will, and he was so intense in his character, and I didn't want to break it, you know, as a director. I'm looking at him trying to get him, this is one of the roles he don't like doing slave type of stuff, you know? So he decided, hey, I'm gonna do this. And I didn't want to break that, hey, Clyde. So he walks up to me, we hug each other like just real hard. Love you, man, love you, okay, boom. So continue, my 2 days were over. It was time for me to go home. Because I was still in character, just constantly, always in character. They thought I was gonna be a preacher. So I left the set, and by the time I left the set, I drove all the way to Natchez, Mississippi. Now I had my makeup was still on. I was getting ready to shave all my stuff off and dye so I can get back handsome, right? So I'm shaving and getting ready to shave all my stuff. I get a call. They said, where are you, Mr. Jones? I said, I'm back in Mississippi. They said, the producers want you back now. They want you to continue this character. Mm. I said, but I'm in Natchez. They said, can you make it here in an hour? I said, Natchez is 2.5 hours away. They said, look, we're gonna send you some dialogue. Try to make it. I'm going, raining. My car got caught in a flood and it was getting ready to stall. And for some reason, it's like the Holy Spirit just pushed my car out of it.
Wow.
I finally get there. I do the roll. And the lady says, Antoine Fuqua. Say, just keep him here. I stayed for 5 weeks, made about $75,000. You know,
that's
from 2 days to 5 weeks, you know, made that money. And then I get another check from Apple, and then they give you a check for $25,000, like a buyout for them. It was just a blessing that the enemy didn't want me to have.
Wow. You know,
so sometimes, like Miguel says, sometimes you just can't say no, you gotta go. You know, face your fears. I'm gonna tell you right now, I tell people, anxiety and panic attacks and all that other stuff, you know, it's there, you know, but it's here.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And we fear things. You can't change nothing when it's what it is. Yeah. You just got to go for it, because tomorrow ain't promised to nobody. You know what I'm saying?
That's so
2 days
turn to five. Wow.
Yeah, yeah. But it's happened. That's, even with Miguel's show, Tour Duty, I had a national commercial and for AT&T, and I was with Cunningham Mascot Depini, and once you say yes to a commercial, then therefore you kind of obligated to that contract. So then Miguel called me from Hawaii. He says, Clyde, this character named Clyde, you know, actually this
wow, that was a stretch.
This is stress. No, there was a guy, he ended up getting mumps, measles, and you know what happens with that. So.
Is that the one you got killed twice? He's telling us.
Well, I only got twice, yeah.
Tour Duty, right?
But watch God, though. Watch this. I get this national commercial, and I tell my agent, I said, look, I want to be an actor more than I want to just do commercials, but I've done a lot of commercials, you know? So when she called, I called, I said, look, I can't do the job. She said, what are you talking about, Clyde? I said, I can't do it. I said, they want me in Hawaii, you know? And Miguel said, Clyde, you have to be ready to go in Hawaii, you know, come on. I said, and I'm caught between these two, because I really wanted to act. So I turned the roll down. I turned that thing down.
Commercial.
And they called my agent back and said, Clyde, tell Clyde, you know, we don't do this for nobody. We wait for him to get back. They waited for me. I went and did Tour Duty.
Wow.
And when I did Tour Duty, I got like 10,000 fan mail. They wrote me back in to kill me again.
Yeah. You know, yes,
because
naturally.
Because the guy who got sick came back. You know what I'm saying? But I got two roles. The same character. They brought him back in.
Yeah. Oh, it is the same character.
It was the same character. They killed him. But see, when they killed me with that little stick, that little bamboo stick, you didn't see I was dead. I was just going, and they would carry me out, right? So they could bring me back, you know?
Ah.
So that's how that was. But it was
you healed.
But watch this. I actually got stuck for real. He hit me. What the man got? Oh, like, yo, so I get killed in all my
You got stuck for real?
Yo, the guy stuck me for real. Cause I had to go in this little hole and he stuck me for real. But
what? No stunt man or nothing?
It was stunt
no
butt.
No stunt?
Stunt butt.
Stunt butt, you know.
Wow.
Butt. Yeah, no. Look, when I was in the Philippines, I did another Vietnam film. And my mom always tell me, brother, they call me brother. Brother, you let me know if you're going to die in this film, but I'm not going to watch it. I said, okay, mom, yo, I'm not going to say nothing. No, you tell me. I said, mom, I'm just not going to say nothing. So I'm in the movie. All the way through, Lee R. Ermey, Full Metal Jacket, the guy, you know, he passed away, good, wonderful guy, worked with him in the Philippines. And so all of a sudden, at the end, my mom like, yeah, man, I'm watching the movie with her. Yeah. Oh, brother, they killed you.
That's her baby.
Awesome. Well, man, thank you so much for being here, Clyde. Wow. I mean,
legend.
You on this side.
Yeah.
Okay,
I'm used to you being over there, being a nuisance.
I know. I'm getting ready to go back and be one, so.
Yay.
But I appreciate it. I appreciate
it's
you.
Number
and there's nowhere you can catch me. You can't catch me on all this stuff. I'm Who Killed Soul Glow. I have a cartoon called The Adventures of Rhonda Rain about.
Who Killed Soul Glow?
We're ready to put it up as a stage for my partner, Michael Manziel, and I. So I have comic books, coloring books, 13 episodes on audio, and it's these characters, Rhonda Rain about Marvin Minoxide, Peter Palute, and Sammy Smog, man, it deals with the environment. So we wrote this 40 years ago, and now, you know, it's beginning to happen. So thank you.
All right. Congratulations. Wow. That's awesome, man. Thank you again for being
here.
Man, Clyde Jones, y'all.
All right.
Wow.
All right.
Thank you for joining us, and we will see you guys next time. You've been watching The Able Show, where we are all able. DJ X-Ray, take us out.